Penguin Random House presents The Professional, Defining the New Standard of Excellence at Work by Subroto Bagchi, read by Derek Denzil. To my daughters, Neha and Neeti. Introduction. Some 15 miles from central Philadelphia, at the northern edge of the city, stands the Conwell Heights train station. It has a large parking lot, and on most weekdays, hundreds of commuters park their cars there before taking the 20-minute train ride to Center City. The name of the residents of the City of Brotherly Love have given to the downtown area. Since the parking lot is some distance away from the platforms, the Southern Pennsylvania Transportation Authority, or SEPTA, which operates Philadelphia's regional trains, runs a shuttle bus between the station and the parking lot. The drivers who operate these buses have an excruciatingly boring job. Hour after hour, they wait for the trains to arrive and then drive the passengers from the station to the parking lot, or the other way around, and then again wait for the next train. As they sit slumped in their seats, most drivers look as though they would do anything to escape the tedium. Curtis Perrin is an exception. Perrin's demeanor and behavior reflect anything but boredom. Each time a passenger enters his bus, he calls out in his gritty, heavy voice, hearty voice, "Hey there, buddy, how are you today?" If an elderly woman enters, Curtis says, "Hello, young lady." Even more remarkable than his wide smile and booming voice is his memory. Curtis remembers the cars that his passengers drive, while other drivers drive along a pre-assigned route. Stopping at parking lots A, B, C, and so on, Curtis usually drives each passenger to his or her own car. As the exhausted passengers alight from the bus, he calls out again, "Have a great evening, buddy," or "Happy Friday, sir." "Have a great weekend." Curtis's way has endeared him to countless passengers. They sometimes bring him gifts when returning from their vacation. Some people bring him brownies and cakes on other occasions. Curtis Perrin is an outstanding professional first and a bus driver second. His professionalism makes him view people as individual customers he serves and not as an anonymous mass of faceless commuters. On their part, people respond and react to Curtis's warmth. They don't see him as an invisible function, but as someone with effective regard for his work. People like Perrin make a real difference to their work and to the people they serve. Curtis Perrin is a professional. The word profession is defined by Merriam-Webster as a calling requiring specialized knowledge and often long and intensive academic preparation. The same dictionary defines a professional as participating for gain or livelihood in an activity or field of endeavor often engaged in by amateurs. Although this is the standard definition, I have found throughout my career that the term professional often seems to imply different things to different people. As someone in the workforce, you probably have your own opinions about what makes a person a professional. Perhaps you adhere strictly to Webster's definition and consider anyone who makes money doing what they do to be a professional, whether he or she is a plumber, a hedge fund manager, or a writer. Or maybe you have a stricter definition, one that requires people to be incredibly good at what they do in order to earn the label. A plumber who starts his own business, a hedge fund manager who earns millions by bringing in clients and managing their investments, a writer who has been published in every major newspaper or magazine in the country. We also harbor notions about how professionals conduct themselves. They dress a certain way, avoid gossip, or refuse to discuss private matters with their colleagues unless it is relevant to their ability to do their job. Even in today's modern and relatively relaxed work environment, I often hear the term professional applied to people who adhere to these standards. But after almost 35 years of life as a professional, I have found that in the new era of the global economy, where every person's actions have the potential to have a global impact, whether good or bad, we must redefine what it means to be a true professional. The word professional has been around for a long time, and its origins are even older. Its root dates back to AD 1175 to 1225 to the Latin word professio, which means an oath taken upon entering a religious order. The reason we need to appreciate the origins of the term is that we live amid scores of qualified engineers, doctors, nurses, architects, lawyers, journalists, sportspersons, and accountants who believe that being a professional is merely a means of earning a livelihood, just another way to get ahead in life, to seek and create further material comfort, and eventually enjoy retirement. For such people, a professional is someone who gets an educational qualification to land a job, then a coveted assignment or posting, followed by a bunch of accelerated increments and promotions. But in my view, a professional, especially now, is something more. Today, it's not enough for someone just to be able to do a job in order to qualify for this title. He or she not only must be able to accept responsibility for their own work and actions, but also must understand how that work and those actions will translate to the rest of the world. Although every country, industry, and company has its own code of conduct, there is no institution large enough or powerful enough to make sure each of us is behaving in the best way possible. Today, more than ever before, we must embrace the traditional meaning of the word professional and take a personal oath promising we will do our best. We will bring our knowledge, skills, and attitude to make a difference to others and to regulate ourselves. And this does not just apply to thought leader or men and women in suits. You could be a software engineer, a cosmetologist, an intellectual property lawyer, or for that matter, a publicist. For some of you, the doctors, lawyers, and journalists, for instance, your profession has existed for a long time, and therefore, you probably already operate under a set of guidelines that has been long established. But for others, your profession may not have existed 100 years ago. Every decade is throwing up brand new professions the world over. On one hand, professionals in their respective fields are expected to be experts in their own disciplines, to understand their nuances, and at the same time, be able to work in tandem with their counterparts in other professions. But most important, they must be able to work across borders. There has been an explosion in the world of professions, and yet there is still no system in place that can train people how to be true professionals. No matter how much education or training you have, there is no instruction manual that tells you how to approach every problem, communicate with different people, and respond to change. As a result, most of us simply bumble our way into critical, multifaceted understanding that separates a professionally qualified, technically competent individual from a handful of true professionals. But there is another challenge to being a professional today. That is the fact that we work globally. Even those of us who don't travel for work often have to communicate with those halfway around the world, and of course, our reliance on international trade means we can easily be affected by an event that occurs or begins abroad. Consider Ishani Mohapatra, who studied chemistry and specialized in non-edible flavoring agents. She completed college in Mumbai, India, but today works as a fragrance development manager at a company called International Flavors and Fragrances, Inc. in Utrecht, the Netherlands. She works as part of a globally dispersed team that helps create new detergent fragrances for one of her company's clients, Procter & Gamble. Or there's my chartered financial analyst, Leslie Davis, who advised me on international tax issues. Davis lives in California, but has clients all over the world who turn to him on dual taxation issues in the course of their businesses with the United States. In Bangalore, India, my dentist, Vivek Nandavar, is seeing an increase in the number of expatriate clients from many different countries as they make the Silicon Valley their place of work. Of late, he has also seen patients come from places like the Middle East who are turning to India as a destination for affordable medical care, often combining it with tourism. I have been working for the past 30 years as a professional. For 15 of these years, I have been an entrepreneur. During this time, I have dealt with customers from all around the world. Even though I'm based in Bangalore, I wake up every morning to calls from Shanghai, London, California, and other places far from home. I travel almost constantly and I've lived overseas. I have raised venture capital money from investors across the world. And in 1999, I co-founded Mindtree, which employs people from many different national origins and operates out of offices in the United States, Europe, Asia, and Australia. Our 9,000 people create software application for companies as diverse as John Wiley & Sons Publishers in the United States and ArcelorMittal Steel Company in Europe. We develop and create technology that is used by companies from Denmark to Korea. Through my work in the software industry and through the work of my colleagues, I routinely transact with professionals from every discipline, technology folks, end users in finance and marketing and human resources, and sometimes medical doctors, lawyers, public relations experts and real estate agents. In the same vein, as an individual who has traveled extensively and lived abroad several times, I have been a customer of a wide variety of professional services and have relied on countless experts from medical doctors to chiropractors to airline agents and auto repairs and cab drivers to help me solve a problem or accomplish a goal that I could not do alone. Each one is a professional whom we expect to satisfy our needs in a timely, cost-effective, inclusive, courteous, and of course, competent manner. This book is as much about people like them as it is about those who readily come to mind when we think of the term professional. It is as much for those who earn six-figure incomes as it is for those who earn minimum wage. In short, it is for everyone who recognizes the need to behave professionally. What defines the true professional? My goal in this book is to answer this question. I believe, at a fundamental level, there are three qualities that make someone a true professional. These are the ability to work unsupervised, the ability to certify the completion of a job or task, and finally, the ability to behave with integrity at all times. But there are facets beyond meeting the base level requirements. The true professional is also self-aware and is not afraid to admit when he or she is wrong, ask for help, or refuse to do something that does not align with his or her values or goals. He understands his limits, but is never afraid to speak up when he feels silence can compromise an ethical boundary. He takes care of his body, soul, and mind, and prioritizes everything he does in order to create maximum value. The true professional has a long view of time. She understands that a profession is not limited to a particular job or organization, but spans the entirety of a 40-plus year career. She makes decisions and builds relationships knowing that the thing she does today can affect her tomorrow, next week, next year, or even 10 years from now. The true professional is one who evolves. He embraces the new challenges that each phase of his career brings and adapts to changes in life, company, industry, or culture. He excels not only at the technical details of his job, but also at the managerial and leadership aspects that come with advancement. The true professional is comfortable dealing with things she was not trained for. As we all know, we live in times when there is a high probability that an unlikely thing, from a natural disaster to a terrorist attack, could happen. The true professional sees these events not as catastrophes, but as opportunities to make a difference. Above all, the true professional understands the imperatives of our global economy. He is culturally aware, connected, and engaged with people around the globe. A final thought before we move on. I'm not a management guru. I'm a practitioner. My main profession is not writing books and lecturing at business schools, but running my software business. Hence, I lay no claim to profound theories born of excruciable research. I'm an observer and a doer. For this reason, my book shuns complexity and, for that matter, sophistication. This is a simple book. It presents practical situations, ideas, and concepts that exemplifies them with everyday lessons. It is not meant to be an academic piece de resistance. It is a workbook for anyone who wants to excel in their careers, not only today, but decades from now. I would deem it worth your time if somewhere it makes you think, find your own how-to, and someday pass it on to others. Because I deeply believe it is simply not enough to be good at your work. A true professional must have a sense of legacy and leave the core of knowledge behind, so that taller trees may one day sprout from the same ground into which we all must eventually fall. Subroto Bagchi. Part 1. Integrity. Chapter 1. Burial of the Dead. Do you work in an entry-level position or even a middle-level job in a hotel, hospital, a software company, or a government organization?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.